Welcome back, Shmoney team. It's me, Amina Tuso.
And I'm Angela Yee, and we are back, baby.
We're back again with another episode of Colorful Lives presented by State Farm to help you increase your financial IQ and to bring your career, business, and life to the next level. And we have a surprise for you.
Yes, we got more shmoney for you.
Hey, guys. It's Tanya from MyFabFinance.
Yes.
She's a Colorful Lives regular, and she's been on here with us before, and now she's permanent.
I know. Y'all loved her so much, we had to make her part of the furniture here.
Look at God.
We loved her so much.
And we're having so much fun. Also, somebody who really knows about money.
Just a little bit. You know, just a little, you know, just I only study it every day.
Yeah, no, I'm excited because that means I'm about to have even more shmoney thanks to you.
And I know it's so crazy because, Angela, I feel like we've, like, talked about money a lot.
Yeah, a couple times.
The past
yeah.
couple years.
I mean, I had a spiritual experience on the show when you came and talked to us last season. Mm-hmm. So
she
hopefully,
talks about that all the time, by the way.
Hopefully, I'm going to get my money right this year and make more money, more wealth, more health. It's going to be great.
You know, make your money make money. That's the goal.
Okay, we're excited for this season. For those of you who do not know... What do I do? I forgot.
Because I don't know.
I am the host of the Breakfast Club. For those of you who don't know, I am the host of a podcast called Call Your Girlfriend.
And your name is?
My name is Amina Tuso. You can call me Amina, like all my friends. And
so if I call you Amina Tuso, I'm not your friend?
It's such a beautiful name.
Listen,
like,
it's great name. It's just like, you know how different people in different phases of your life call you different things?
Right.
Like, my parents have a name that they call me. My friend, my family has a name that they call me. My whatever. Like, that's just, that's cool.
They call me Rap. Like
my Rap?
Rap. Literally, yeah. I'll explain it.
I want people to call me Cash. Can I change my name?
Oh, my gosh. But, yeah, so go ahead. Run it down.
I'm the host of a podcast called Call Your Girlfriend. I am writing a forthcoming memoir. I know.
I like how she tried to drop that in there, like,
Goal achieved. It was one of my accountability goals with you. I am on the advisory board for the Sundance Film Festival and, you know, do a bunch of other jobs. It's very exciting.
She's popping, basically.
Basically.
Listen, a lot of jobs.
Future New York Times bestseller.
Inshallah.
All of it.
Well, I'm Angela Yee, and I'm one of the hosts on The Breakfast Club. I also own a juice bar called Juices for Life in Brooklyn.
It's delicious.
I have another podcast called Lip Service, and, you know, just I have a book club as well that I'm really excited about, and we're going to talk about that for accountability as well. So, and I have other things that I'm starting that I'm excited to get into later, but let's get to you, Tanya.
Yeah, so I'm Tanya Rapley. I'm founder of MyFabFinance, also known as the Millennial Money Expert. And I started finance back in 2013 because I just realized my finances were a wreck. And now it's a full-time job. Like, I'm a content creator, on-air talent with a lot of different brands and just really helping people get their financial lives together.
We need that.
You know, it's paycheck to paycheck. It's just not, it doesn't have to be our reality. And I really specialize in helping people own their power. So I'm the author of a best-selling book called The Money Manual, which was self-published, and I released it back in May. And that was a labor of love.
Right.
Like, yeah. But incredibly excited about everything else. Like, I'm passionate about merging money, entertainment, because it doesn't have to be boring. And that's what I loved about being on this podcast last year, is that you guys made it so fun talking about money.
I'm surrounded by authors, so I'm starting to feel like it might be my destiny sooner than I think.
Off. Listen, okay. I'm surrounded by homeowners, so I hope it's my destiny soon. if that's the game that we're playing.
Now, Tanya, since you're permanent now, let's talk about accountability check-ins, because we always do this every time we start on Colorful Lives. So what the accountability check-in is, we talk about things that we've wanted to accomplish, goals that we had, and we hold ourselves accountable. So I make sure that Amina does what she's supposed to do. She makes sure I do what I'm supposed to do. And now we make sure you do what you're supposed to do.
That's good. I need that.
We accomplished all of our goals that we started at the beginning of the year. Do you realize that?
That's so dope.
We did pretty damn good. You know what?
Did
I think
really well.
It helps so much when you speak it into existence, and then you know people are watching your moves, and
like,
then I know you're going
to
ask me.
I know. I'm very shame motivated, so if I say I'm going to do something, I have to do it.
But they say that you won't be ashamed to fail by yourself, but you're afraid to fail in front of other people. And that's a real thing. Like, most people aren't fearful of failing. They're fearful of failing in front of others.
Right.
That's
whatever
true.
It takes. And I'm still, the next thing for you, Amina, is the talk show.
Listen, I'm working on it. I'm going to have some exciting news this season.
All right, good.
Don't worry. Working
I'm
on
putting it.
It
out there.
I'm working on it. Angela's my manager.
You got to come through me. So are there things that you accomplished, Tanya, that you want to share with us that you had on your checklist?
Well, okay. So when I started my business, I'm very transparent about this on MyFabFinance. I self-funded, so I created debt. And I was really ashamed of that as a financial educator. Like, how do you create debt as a financial educator? But I didn't take money to build my business. And so I was self-funding. So I've been working to aggressively eliminate that debt. So far this year, I've paid off, I think, $11,000 of that debt that I had accumulated. So I'm really excited about that. And, I'm pregnant. And that was a goal.
Yeah.
So that was part of like a 4-year plan, is that I wanted to be employed for myself for 2 years before I got pregnant, because I worked at a job. I saw how my coworkers were struggling to deal with morning sickness and everything else working for someone else. So I was like, you know what? When I get pregnant, I'm going to be working for myself and I'm going to be able to generate income to take care of my family. And so like, yeah, I'm pregnant. The baby just kind of fell into the plan.
That's exciting.
So that's really like, it's hard to think of a baby as like an accountability goal or a goal, but you know, you got to plan. A baby is a financial decision. Like, you know, it's a life change and it's going to affect your finances. And so I'm really happy about that goal coming
to fruition. I feel like that's a shmoney baby and that baby's going to bring some money
baby,
too.
Baby shmoney.
Baby, like this baby don't even know.
This baby needs its own Instagram account yesterday. Gotta start pulling your weight around here.
Because I don't want to be that person whose Instagram turns into their baby's Instagram. Like,
no, you got to give the baby a separate Instagram.
Yeah, they have to have their own Instagram.
And then that way you can gift it to him if Instagram is still relevant when he's Instagram age.
Oh my God.
Here you go. I built up your platform.
Right.
Here you go. Like, it's a sweet 16 birthday gift.
That's crazy to have to think like that if Instagram is still relevant.
Because, I mean, nobody thought MySpace was going to be irrelevant.
Right. Like, it's like, who knows?
I still have my account.
Well, did anybody have a Black Planet account?
I did, yeah.
I did not.
I actually
have a Black
Planet Planet's
account.
Launch party.
Did you? I didn't have a MySpace account either. I used to be very wary of social media.
Wow.
It's powerful.
I know. I had a Friendster account. Anybody remember Friendster?
No.
I remember Friendster, but I just never got the hang of it.
I'm too young for Friendster. It's
Damn
true.
It.
I never got that. But yeah, so, and then my goal, were we going to talk about our goals for the end of the year? I guess I
know.
Just,
what are a couple goals that you want to achieve this year?
My only goal is to buy a multifamily property in Los Angeles.
Oh,
so we're
only,
looking, that's all I can.
That's it?
That's like all I can. Like,
that's a
huge undertaking.
It is. So yeah, I'm just praying, like, yeah, that and hiring a nanny. I want to be able to hire a nanny when we have the baby. But yeah, we're looking at buying a fourplex or a triplex in Los Angeles, probably in the Slauson area or Leimert Park or Mid-City. And so it's been a huge undertaking. My husband and I both work for ourselves, and so buying a house as an entrepreneur is just a whole other ball game. So pray for us.
We will be praying.
But that's the goal.
That's real.
Well, for myself, some things that I want to do is, you know, I've been doing a lot more charity work as of late. And I think as an entrepreneur, I also want to make sure that the things that I do are things that benefit other people. So, you know, that was part of the reason for opening the juice bar. So I'm also starting a pressed juice business.
Oh my God.
So I'm in the process of getting that off the ground. It's going to be subscription based. So it's completely different from what I do now. And it's really going to be helpful to people. But with that being said, I want this to be something that can be taken over into schools.
I love it. Yeah.
You know, so I want to make sure, because kids, a lot of times, they're not getting the right things that they need to start their day off in school, and it's causing them to have, like, you know, lack of attention.
Yeah.
They're being diagnosed with things like ADD when it's really just their diet, I think, you know, could change a lot about their attentiveness and all of that. So that's something I'm really interested in doing. You guys know I have my book club, so I'm trying to take that up to another level. And figure out how I can make that something bigger and better. So that's another undertaking. I have a lot of things that I want to do. I started a running club. And so that's
so
just,
cool.
Yeah, just getting off the ground. So that's exciting for me, because I know a lot of times we talk about, like, oh, people got to exercise more. You got to do this more. We got to be concerned about our health. And I want to be one of those people that motivates people and actually does something instead of just saying, oh, people have to do this. I want to actually put things into motion to encourage people to want to do those things.
I love that you're doing a running club.
I love
when
that.
I drop this baby, I'm coming to run with you.
You could walk with us.
I know.
The pressure is on.
All right.
All right.
And Amina?
Me? I don't have any goals this year. I'm done.
You a liar.
Actually, it's funny that you're starting a running club, because one of my goals this year is to run a 5K.
Mm-hmm.
I for a long time I was like, I'm like, I can do it, but do I want to do it? No. And also I hate exercise accountability, as we found out last year. But I was like, you know, running a race, that's a good goal.
Right.
And then that way, I'm just going to figure it out. So
I'm here for you.
I know. Listen.
And I'll be expecting you to be at all of the running clubs. It's only going to meet once a month. And my hope is that people can break off into their own groups.
As long as you're not meeting in the summer.
Mm-hmm.
As long as you're not meeting in the summer, I'm there.
We are meeting in the summer, girl.
It's going to be hot.
After the sun goes down.
Okay, yeah, perfect.
After the sun goes down.
No, I'll be there. Also, you're meeting right next to my house. So this is perfect.
It's really new. I'm going to knock on your door.
No, come on down.
Now that's an accountability check.
That is.
I want to run a 5K. The other thing is, if you remember last year, my goal was to set up all of my retirement stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I did that.
Yay.
I have a SEP IRA. Yeah, girl, it's probably going to retire well one day. It's like all perfect. But this year, what I want to do is build up my savings fund, because it got depleted while I was sick. I didn't work for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and also, like, savings is how you ward off all sorts of emergencies
mm-hmm.
that you have. And so my goal is to have a year's worth of salary saved.
Okay.
And it's very aggressive. And it's brought out a lot of stuff for me, where I just realize all of the impulse shopping that I do.
Hello.
And
ding, ding.
Just like, you know, the... the really complicated relationship that I have with saving and what it means, and you know, it's because I'm somebody who takes care of my family a lot, and you know, I went through this like big health crisis and all these things, and so I feel that for me, in order to be secure and to feel safe, and I can do this, I just need to do it. But also, saving means a lot of sacrifice for me, and I chafe at that a lot. And it's been really interesting to see the things that I'm willing to give up and the other things where I'm like, I don't know about this, and putting myself on a really strict budget, because I cheat on the budget all the time.
Yeah, and that's important, to giving yourself that flexibility in the budget, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is because it's like, you know, I look at it as like a diet. If you tell yourself, like, yeah, I can't have sweets anymore for the rest of the year, you're going to have sweets. But if you say, you know what, Sunday is my cheat day, then
right,
you'll look forward to Sunday. And I think savings and creating your budget is the same way. Like, you still have to have things you enjoy doing.
Right, but it's like looking at saving, you know, like as a game, or even as, you know, like another form of taking care of yourself is,
yeah,
like, yes, I'm investing in my future self. And this is a way that I will be financially secure in the future, and that any of these like family emergencies or my own emergencies or healthcare emergencies are not going to come to scare me.
Mm-hmm.
But it's, you know, like a year's worth of salary is a lot.
Yeah,
it is. And you know,
it's a lot.
You talked about retirement, and for so long, I've always been concerned about how am I going to be able to retire comfortably and not have to worry about, am I going to have enough money to pay my bills? You know, a lot of times you see people that are working well past the age that they thought they would,
yeah,
retire because,
yeah,
they have to,
yeah,
and not necessarily because they want to, and I don't want to be in that position.
Yeah.
And I was telling you guys before we started this, I was reading an article about how you should have paid off all your debts by the time you're 45 years old,
mm-hmm,
to prepare for retirement. And I feel like, including your mortgage, and I feel like for a lot of people, that's kind of like a, you know, that's scary.
That is.
Because I'm not going to have my mortgage paid off by that time.
I know. Well, as somebody who doesn't have a mortgage, the other goal that I have is to get all of my financial stuff in order,
mm-hmm,
so that I can look into buying a house next year. And, it, you know, I don't like paperwork. I don't not only do I not like paperwork, I don't like being confronted with my spending habits and with my money in just this laid out way, which buying a house is just that.
It's so invasive.
Just like, yeah, buying a house is like just putting yourself on blast all the time and telling people your salary and your spending habits, especially when you're self-employed. It's just, it's terrifying. So I'm trying to figure out all the things that I need to do so that if next year...
I can help you so much with that, because you're you trying to buy a house in Brooklyn, right?
Yes.
And so when I did that, and that was really only about 4 years ago, I can tell you like the whole entire process of what I went through, because Brooklyn, you know, New York in general is a very specific type of market.
Yeah.
Just,
no, but it's so competitive and scary.
That's why I'm saying it's very specific, because it is very competitive. So I definitely can give you a lot of tips about that.
That's
but
it can be done.
I know. And Tanya's hooking me up with a financial planner, because I need to figure out what to do with my book advance money.
Mm. Yeah, and he's awesome.
Because, you know, I already told you, that falls into my fake money bucket. I was like,
so that's not going towards buying a house?
I mean, maybe
you can
it
set
is.
It up that
it's
way
just,
you tell them your
I'm just like, I have a windfall. I look at it as a windfall, even even though technically it is salary, but I'm like, I
windfall.
No, it's true. But I'm like, no, I fake money. Yeah, I'm like, it's fake money for me. Like, I, you know, I was like, there are things that I do that I'm like, this is how I live my life every day. Everything else is just extra. Mm-hmm. And so I want to, you know, and we got like a pretty good advance. So I want to figure out how what I'm going to do with that money. And also book payments are done in four portions. So, you know, in, you know, like in 3 years and four payments, how much money you have. And so I need to like plan taxes for that. I need to figure out if I want to put it in savings or if it's going to be an investment or if it's going to be, you know, like a down payment for a house. I need to figure all of that out.
You know, yeah. I just want to say, if you are ready to start thinking about buying a house, you should start looking now, because it's going to take a while to even find the house that you want.
Ooh, girl.
And it's important for you to educate yourself. Like, it took me over a year to find my house, right?
Yeah.
So that's why I'm saying start looking now. But I also, during that time, didn't know anything about, you know, buying a home and getting a mortgage. And I got pre-approved and I had no idea how much I could even really afford.
Yeah, it is important to go through that process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then if you find a house that you like and you're pre-approved for a certain amount, it's so much easier for you to get it because it is competitive. Like, a house will go on the market and be gone that same day. But if you're pre-approved, then they already know that you're able to buy that house.
I'm already sweating.
But the reason why I say start looking now is because it's not a rush for you right now, because you might not be exactly
your lease
ready.
Isn't up necessarily,
yeah,
or
it's
you don't
true.
Have. And by
it's
the
true.
Time that you're ready,
like, you're not pregnant, like, you know, you're trying to get anywhere, you're trying to get settled before the baby comes.
No, but
my point is, by the time
I need to figure it out.
Because when I started looking, I didn't have enough money saved up for a down payment or anything yet. But I was like, let me start looking, because that way I started looking at houses and it educated me a lot on what to look for in a house, you know, and what neighborhoods and what the houses were going for in certain areas, and to be able to ask educated questions, because the first few houses I looked at, I didn't know what I was looking for until you go and you learn different things and you learn the terminology, and then you're like, okay, I want to make sure that I have, you know, a 3-family house. I don't want a bus stop in front of my house because I don't want people lingering in front of my house when I'm, you know, walking out the door. I want to make sure that I have brick. I want to, you know about the wiring for the electrical. There's a lot of things that you might not think about, but once you start looking at houses, you'll become like an expert, almost like a real estate agent yourself, so that when you walk into a house, you can ask questions and they'll know you know what you're talking about and you'll feel more confident.
I think it lights the fire under you too, you know, because you're like, okay, I'm out here looking at houses. I've got my pre-approval. No, this has to happen, you know, and you just become more committed to that goal because it feels that much more real when you start looking. And I think sometimes I priced myself out of neighborhoods I thought I couldn't afford.
That's what happened to
me. I was like, no, there's no way. And then we started looking at places. I'm like, oh, we can actually afford to live here, like Leimert Park. So I live in Los Angeles.
I love Leimert
Park. And
Leimert
Park is a community that I absolutely love. And it's been gentrified. So, you know, it's not as affordable as it used to be. And we were looking, I was like, no, there's no way we can afford Leimert Park. And our agent started showing us places that were within our budget and how we would make it work. And so you don't know until you start looking. So I definitely agree with Angela that
start
it may
now.
Seem like it's far off, but it's not as far off as you would think it would be. And you might need that time to get things.
And look at all this encouragement. Your girl might buy a house.
And I promise you, like, when you're not in a rush to do it, it's actually kind of fun. Like, when you're not, like, under the gun and under pressure, like, I have to do this. I have only 3 months. Like, if you can leisurely be like, okay, let me go look. Let me go to this open house. Or let me get 3 different realtors so they can show me different things.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
That way it's not pressure. And you can just go and like, okay, I like this. Oh, I don't like this. I like this neighborhood. Oh, this is what this costs over here. Or I never thought about this neighborhood.
But yeah, also it is important also to point out that some houses can be like money pits.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't know what you're getting yourself into and you don't do that research ahead of time, like, you could make a bad decision. And I always say, like, all homes aren't investments. Like, the wrong home is a bad investment. The right home is a good investment. So you really want to make sure that that particular property makes sense for you. And everyone shouldn't be home buyers. Like, I honestly did not want to buy a home until more recently. And that's because I felt like I knew why I was buying a home, not just because my parents were like, okay, this is next step. You got your master's degree. Now you got to buy a house.
Yeah.
Rather than understanding how it fit into my plan and that we plan to stay somewhere for a while. So I know we're talking about home ownership, but I also want to say, like, that's not for everybody at this point of their life.
You have to be realistic.
And that's also like why I'm not stressed out about it. You know, like, my big goal for last year was getting my stuff together for retirement. I was like, if I, at the stage of life that I'm at, one of the biggest priority that I had was retirement. I was like, I'm 30 something. I haven't really paid attention to it. And you know, that stuff like accumulates really fast. It's like, if you're not starting to plan for retirement in your 20s, you're already behind the ball in your 30s. Right. And, you know, it's just something I didn't start
planning for that until my 30s.
Either. Right. It's like, I think about how many jobs I had that had, like, you know, matching plans that I didn't look into and that stuff. But, you know, we're not going to live in regret.
Can I go back and fine.
It does not serve
you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It doesn't serve you. But I just, you know, it's like, that was a decade of mistakes. And, you know, when you know better, you obviously understand the impact of it. I'm like, I'm going to be fine. But I just see where all of that stuff is. And so, you know, and I think that you're right. It's like home ownership. It's like it's for people whenever you want it to be. But like one of the things that we can focus on is, you know, really figuring out like what that goal can serve you.
Because I want to make sure I own my home by the time I retire. I really do. Mm-hmm. Like, I want to make sure when it's time to retire, I don't have to worry about paying a mortgage anymore. You know, I have a two-family house, and that was important to me when I bought a house, to make sure that I had some income. So it helps with my mortgage a lot. And another thing I would say you have to do is get a home inspector. Like, if you decide that you want to, because, you know, this goes back to what Tanya said about how a house could potentially be a money pit. You know, the first house I put an offer in on would have been a money pit. And I only knew that because I had someone come and inspect the home.
Yeah.
And he was like, look, I don't think you should buy this house. I'm going to be honest with you.
Well, thank God for him.
He said, you should spend a little more. And I didn't know I could spend more until I hadn't gotten pre-approved at that time. So I didn't know what I could afford. So he was like, just spend a little bit more and get a real brownstone. It'll be, the value of that will be so much more for you. And this house just...
That's a real education.
Send that man an edible arrangement. Like.
No, and the truth of the matter is, it costs money to hire a home inspector, but it saves you so much money in the long run. So I just think that's a, you know, something really valuable that I learned.
Well, listen, you know how we got so many questions from all the listeners that use the hashtag LiveColorful. That's LiveColorful with two L's. So I think that moving forward, we're going to start actually answering some of these. So the first question that we got says, I'm an adult student who graduated from Smith and I'm looking to continue my education. Congrats, girl. Mm-hmm. It's at Matt France on Instagram and Twitter. But I'm also hearing a lot about saving for retirement. How do I decide where to start when it comes to saving? This is such a good question because it goes to that, like, what are your priorities and what are the things that you're supposed to have in order?
And it also goes into, like, what is your life? And in all honesty, because I think that, for example, if you have parents that you know will be self-sufficient by the time, you know, you get into your career and by the time you start having a family, then your goals are going to look completely different than someone who knows that they'll most likely be taking care of their parents. Mm-hmm. And you have to plan differently. And it's interesting that just graduated from Smith. One thing I do see a lot of college students do now, and I think it's great, but I think they overwhelm themselves like, I have to have it all figured out right now. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you just got to figure out what's going to happen for your career. Like, are you going to be working in your career? Are you going to be working in a career path? Will a 401k will be offered to you, or will you be freelance? Like, what will you be doing in your career?
And also you're like saddled with debt. You know
what
I mean?
Like, you have to settle. I think that a lot of students, they get a lot of anxiety because of the news. We're always talking about deficits. There's not going to be any Social Security. There's not going to be any Medicare, But it's like, you also have to, like how snow settles to the ground, you kind of just have to let your life kind of settle and see what your responsibilities are going to be and what you're bringing in before you say, before you make declarations about, I'm going to do this and do that. Because you might get a job where you're barely able to save. That was my first job out of college. Like,
that's
I was barely able
jobs
to save.
Out of college.
Right.
Yeah. Like, I was working at a call center. Went to school for public administration working at a call center, you know?
Yeah. I was making $21,000 my first year.
And I was making $23,000.
You know what I mean? It's like, I can't believe I lived off
that.
And I lived. I was like, I used to like go out on weekends. Like, I don't know how I did that.
It's like, please don't do that to me again. Like, I don't know how. Like,
no,
I truly do
not know how. But I also think, you know, the reason that I actually like this question is because for as much as a lot of students stress out and they freak out, they also just don't make plans, you know?
Mm-hmm,
so I think that having a serious, like, come to Jesus with yourself and saying, what are my priorities?
Yeah.
If you, and I would say that, you know, there's a lot of expert advice on there, but you really need to look at yourself and what your capacity is and what your obligations are. And I would say, like, I graduated college with no student debt, but that's also like, you know, I was like, I was an international student. I didn't have to pay for it. But if I had had debt, that would have been the thing that I would say, like, how am I going to meet my debt obligation every month? Because that is, it looms large. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and the way that I am, like, carrying that kind of debt, I know would just, it just, like, eat me up inside.
But the thing about student loan debt is that a lot of people don't realize that the interest that you pay on student loan debt, the rate of return that you would get on investments is actually higher.
Yeah.
And so a lot of people focus on their student loan debt, but it's like, that's like the least threatening debt that you have. Now, if you have a lot of consumer debt, then we need to aggressively eliminate that. But you might be able to put, you might be able to get on a pay-as-you-earn plan for your student loans or something that's more affordable that frees you up to do other things with your money so that your money's actually working for you in your younger age. Because we do know the younger you start investing, the more time that money has to compound.
Even if it's $50 a month.
Even if it's $50. Right. Like, you know, I had nothing, like, up until, nothing, like, 27.
But I put myself in the habit of always saving something. Like, it didn't matter how it was because I was like, this is discipline. And I would have, I think it was, like, $40 taken out of my, like, tiny check every month.
But that's good. And,
but at the end of the year, I was like, that's money that I didn't have before. I was like, I had zero.
Great. Yeah. I wish I would have.
You know, and now I have, like, a couple $100s. But I think that, like, building that discipline for yourself and also, like, not being afraid to go and ask an expert. Like, a lot of people think that, like, a lot, you know, they just sit there with their own shame and their own lack of information, or they're like talking to their friends who are just as clueless at them as them. And it's like, pick up the phone, look at the internet, talk to a professional and say, like, here's my student loan debt. Here's how much I have in rent. Here's the lifestyle that I want to live. Like, here's the, like, what do I need to do to get there?
Yeah.
Because sitting there with your own shame and your anxiety, that is not going to help anybody.
And
you need to make a plan.
And I just remember, it took me, I think, like, 12 years to pay off my student loans because I deferred them a few times. But I remember after I paid off my student loans, I was like, okay, I'm so used to paying this amount every month that instead of my student loan, because I didn't start, you know, my IRA until I was in my 30s, my early 30s. Mm-hmm. But I was like, you know what? Since I don't have to pay this student loan anymore, I'm going to take that money and put the money that would have been going to my student loan into my IRA.
Yeah, just pay yourself with it. And one of the things I do love, there's a lot of resources, and letsstarttoday.com is a great resource, especially if you want to start looking at retirement, because life comes at you fast. Mm-hmm. Like, I feel like I was just graduating from college a few years ago, and life comes at you fast. And so you can use, we have tips and resources available. So you can actually start to look at what retirement might look like for you, what you want in retirement, because I think we have an idea of what our retirement would look like. Like, we're going to retire maybe in, like, Palm Springs and drive an RV around the United States and just, like,
wow, you're describing my retirement.
You know, but
I'm hoping to live on an island somewhere.
And that's not, you know, like, different realities based on your planning. And so that really helps you put things into perspective. Okay, I need to have this amount of money set aside by this amount of time if I want to live like this.
Exactly. And also, like, you know, paying attention to the news and paying attention to policy, because, you know, like, there's all this scaremongering right now about what Social Security is going to look like. But the truth is that we don't know what Congress is going to do or not do in the next 25 years.
Sure,
so you can't.
They don't know.
That's not, I think that, like, if you're somebody who is a millennial, like, that money is not money you should be counting on. You should count on yourself and what you can do. And the truth is that you will probably contribute more to a system that will not give you back those returns. But, you know, I would say that if you have a job and your company has a matching 401k, that's actually the perfect place to start.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you don't have to max it out. You probably cannot afford it if you're, like, a normal college student.
Yeah.
But start, you know, and it's also where you build in this discipline of, like, take the money out of your paycheck before you even see it. It's not a, you know, setting up those automatic payments and doing it every month, and also just, like, getting to know what your company benefits are, because these are decisions that you're, when you start to know these things, they're going to factor into the kinds of jobs that you take.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? Where you're like, oh, I don't want to work for this company because they don't have good maternity benefits. Mm-hmm. They don't have a matching 401k or whatever. It's part, like, your compensation package is actually all of that. Your compensation package is not just what you get as a salary. And a lot of people, you know, and a lot of people don't think about that.
Right.
And so, you know, like, I love that you said that, like, your, you know, like, planning to have a baby was a 4-year thing. And I see this a lot where people are like, I want to have a kid one day. And then they don't look at the benefits that their future employers will give them, or they start, like, hating their job. And it's like, well, but the truth is that this job is the job that will give you the best benefit for the lifestyle that you want to have.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, you know, in your 20s, even if you're, you know, some people are blessed and they go into, like, working for Goldman Sachs and, like, all those things and they can figure it out. But even if you are working at a tiny nonprofit and you're not making any money, you can start getting that information now and you can start forming those habits now. It's not about, you know, we've said this so many times. a lot of financial planning is not about becoming a millionaire. It's literally about learning how to manage the money that you have and how to live the lifestyle that you want to live. And
absolutely.
Then you can figure that out for yourself.
And sometimes for me, what has always worked is setting goals for myself and knowing that the sacrifices that I make financially is actually for a purpose that I want to achieve something. You know, like talking about buying a house, you know, for the period of time that I knew I was going to do that, I made so many sacrifices. And I like to shop. I wasn't shopping. I wasn't really going out. I wasn't going on vacations or anything, you know, and I was working really hard doing every side job that I could do to get extra money to save up and put in the bank, because I knew that at some point really soon I wanted to buy a house and I wanted to make sure I had as much money as possible for my down payment so that I could get a better interest rate on my mortgage and have, you know, lower payments.
Exactly.
So that, I think when you have goals in mind of what it is that you want to do, that also will affect, you know, how you save your money.
I also want to go back to the question though, because the question was really that she wants to further her education. And so, you know, you like, you think about grad school, and grad school can either be an investment or a money pit.
Yeah.
It's the same thing as a house.
Sure, it can be.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, sometimes I talk
There's
to people.
No telling.
Like, you know, I talk
time.
To people and you're like, you study what? And you owe how much? And you're at the, you know, you're like at the back of the line for doing this. My, you know, like, my story is classic. I wanted to go to law school more than anything in the world. And then the recession happened. And I supported my family. And I was like, I can't do this. I truly. Truly, there was, if it had been a different year and the economy had been different, like, you'd be talking to Amina Esquire, but that's not what happened. But when I think about it now, I actually don't have that regret. I was like, oh, I got to exactly where I wanted to go to, and I figured it out. Mm-hmm. And the thing is that, like, you have to think of your education that way. Is it an investment, or is it just, or are you just avoiding getting into the real world?
Right.
And if you decide,
And
if you decide that it's an investment, you need to start finding ways to pay for it. It's like, who is going to give you a grant? Who is going to give you a scholarship? How much can you work? And also, how do different, you know, like, How is that? A lot of grad students like get salaries from their school essentially because you become a TA. And thinking about that stuff, it's like, how is it going to affect your finances? And what happens if your student aid comes in late, or you know, if like the law changes or something? And it's like, well, now you have to pay higher taxes on that. Like, the new tax bill that we're having will have significant impact on people who are going through graduate programs. Mm-hmm. And you need, you know, and you need to decide for yourself, because borrowing like hundreds of thousands of dollars to further your education, it might be worth it, but in some cases, it is in fact not worth it.
But sometimes you can't tell.
Yeah, so I think it's important to understand that there are options when it comes to school. Well, first of all, when someone tells me they have certain educational goals, I often ask them, is this for you or is this for your family? Mm-hmm. Because a lot of people go to school for... Yeah, they go to school for someone else.
My dad's a doctor. He wants me to be a doctor also, even though I don't want to.
Right, like, you go to school for someone else and you're living someone else's life, and we wonder why people are miserable. And it's because they're living someone else's life, not their ideal life. And then you have debt related to that.
And also, life used to be different, right? Where people will tell you, like, I was janitor and I put myself through law school, and it's like, sir, it's 2018.
Like, ain't
like,
no janitor
money is different. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's like work study is different now.
School is increasingly more expensive. So, 1987, 1988, the tuition at a private nonprofit 4-year institution school was what, $15,000? $15,160. And then last year, the same school cost more than double at $34,740.
Listen, I went to Wesleyan. Do you know how much the tuition at Wesleyan is? Oof. Hold on, let me Google that for you guys.
You know, but
it's
like,
crazy. I'm like, wow. That's...
And this is undergrad. You know what I mean? It's like thinking about somebody who's undergrad, like, getting $120,000 plus of debt, right? To come out and work at a job where you're probably going to be making $30,000 a year.
Yes, if you're lucky.
You got to think about that. You
Wesleyan
really...
is $52,474 a year.
Graduate.
Oh my gosh.
You
graduate with like
year.
A mortgage. That's a North Carolina mortgage.
Yeah.
Like, if you take out student loans, that's a mortgage
but
in like
times
Atlanta.
Four, right? Like, isn't that nuts? And the thing is that...
Undergrad. You haven't even went to grad school.
Mm-hmm. That's undergrad. And the thing is that, like, even the way that we do education in this country... if you have goals that you want, they're looking into community college and looking into options that can make it affordable for you. Mm-hmm. Because the truth is that the way that the economy is set up right now, the scam is that you are just signing your name onto debt that you don't fully understand the impact
of. Exactly. 18 years
old. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you are 18 and you are taking on, like, more money than most people make in their whole lives.
Yeah.
And you're coming out into an economy that is not in great shape. And, you know, and it's, I think about all these kids, especially who want to live in some of these expensive cities,
yeah.
you know, and like I didn't come from a wealthy family, so there was nobody, there was no financial net to fall on. And I think that really having a real conversation with yourself about, am I doing this because it's a name brand and it's a status mm-hmm. and it's a whatever, or it's somebody else's dream, or actually, here are the goals that I have for myself, and here is how I can do that and be in great shape in 4 years, in 10 years, in 20 years.
Well, here's a good trick, because we talked about community colleges, right? You can actually go to community college and take some of the required coursework for a lot of major yeah. degrees, and that will cut your tuition bill in half, and then you can actually, from most schools, transfer some or all of those credits yeah. and get that diploma from whatever school that you actually graduate from.
Absolutely, and one of the things I did, actually, is I had a four-year scholarship to my undergraduate institution, and I went there for free for 2 years, and then I transferred to the school I actually wanted to go
to. There you go. Yeah.
And so half and half. And then when I got to the other school, I negotiated with them. So I ended up, you know, where there's a will, there's a way. And when you want to save money, you'll find it. And so I ended up looking through their course catalog for all the discounts that they offered, anything that I could qualify for. And I got an out-of-state tuition waiver. So technically I paid in-state tuition, even though I was an out-of-state tuition student. And I was able to negotiate with that with them ongoing for the next couple of years.
This is America. You can negotiate anything.
You'd be so surprised. Like, they'll find something for you. And then I ended up working for the school. So I had work study. And then I ended up working for the research institution at the school. So I was getting paid to work for them. And then my work study also came through them. And then I got a scholarship through them my next year at that school. So, like, there's
basically,
so
you
options.
Got paid to go to college.
Basically, like, I spend money, but I make money. Like, you know what I mean?
I know, but and you came out on top, right? It's like, imagine if you hadn't gotten all those breaks and it took some work to do and it, you know, like.
And it was so worth it.
Yeah.
But I still got grad school debt.
Right.
Like, you know, but at least I don't have as much debt as someone who has undergrad and graduate school.
Oh,
debt.
When I think about undergrads who have $100,000 plus of debt, I physically get sick.
But, you know, that's the reality. And also, I know we've spoken about a lot of kids, but there are a lot of people who are returning to college because they went into the workforce and they're realizing that people, you know, they might need a degree for a promotion or to be taken seriously in their career path or whatever it may be. And so it's important for them to understand there are a lot of grants for people returning back to college or who are, you know, single mothers and so forth. And there's so much money out there. And I remember talking to someone who administered grant funds, and they said, they aren't applying for the money. Like, we have the funds here, and people just aren't applying for it.
Right.
I think
do
a lot
your
of people,
research.
Yeah.
They don't know about it. And if you really want to make it happen, you can find some type of scholarship.
Find it. I think people count themselves out before they actually start doing the research. Understand? They're just waiting for someone to give money to.
Right. You know, and also, like, if you're a college student, I would say stop stressing out and asking your peers what they're doing with their lives and ask people who have the jobs that you want to have what their paths was.
Because your peers don't
because
know.
Because, you know, like, your peers don't know. They're in the same boat as you. They're just as clueless as you. And the truth is that, you know, the nature of work is changing a lot. Mm-hmm. I am not doing the thing. I, like, went to college to study government and political science and Middle Eastern studies. I thought I was going to be Christian Amanpour. And here I am. You know, it's like work changes. Life will throw you all sorts of curveballs. So if you think about college as a place where you get tools to figure out the rest of your life, as opposed to, I'm majoring in this thing, this is the thing that I'm going to do, that's the best thing that you can do.
And
for
use the alumni network at the school that you go to. That's so important. Like, people that go to Wesleyan or went to Wesleyan hit me up all the time. People that went to my high school or still go there will hit me up and be like, hey, I'm going to Poly. And you have a sort of, like, you know, you feel endeared. Like, okay,
make
you know, this
proud.
Person
make
went to.
Degree.
Yeah, I mean, this is literally, but this is literally what you pay for. Like,
right,
you don't pay
that connection.
Yeah,
and people want to help out other
you
people.
You pay
that
for college for networking connections. Mm-hmm. You're not paying to, like, learn how to do things. Like, you can figure that out on your own. You
Absolutely.
Pay. You pay for the club, and so the club needs to be worth
like
it.
Like, when you're there, I remember at Wesleyan we had a career resource center, so you could go there and literally get internships from alumni. Then when you could look at any category that you wanted to work in, and I did a lot of internships just going to the career resource center, saying, okay, they're taking interns here. Let me apply for these internships, and that's how I got internships.
And I'm happy you said that, because college is also what you make it.
Mm-hmm.
And just getting that degree doesn't mean you're going to be successful. And you have to put that work in. You have to make this the connection. positions, you have to build your resume as well, because just because you graduate doesn't mean that people are going to hand you a job. It's all about what you did while you were in school.
You're literally signing up to go to the bottom, to the end of the line. But so, mm-hmm. you know, it's like, I'm thinking about the person who asked this question. I wish you a lot of luck. Sit down, figure out what you want to do, mm-hmm. and, you know, and do that and invest in yourself in the future. Like, don't be ruled by somebody else's idea of what your life can be.
And research some grants, like we mm-hmm. said, and research some scholarship opportunities.
And also just understand what your responsibilities will be going forward, and really have that conversation with your parents. Are they planning for retirement? Because if your parents aren't planning for retirement, your retirement's going to look different.
Woo!
You know, and like, your adulthood's going to look different, and your ability to plan for your retirement is going to look different. So you really want to have that conversation to make sure, just to understand what kind of burdens you're going to have going
yeah.
forward.
Well, that's all we have time for this week. That was a lot, y'all.
I know. I'm excited.
Now, like, I feel like I need to call my dad and talk about his return.
Listen,
my parents get tired of me. They're like, listen, we know what we're doing.
An accountability check-in for you. I mean, I have another thing for you. I want you to start looking at homes. I'm actually going to refer you.
Oh, I thought you were going to give me more homework. Okay, no, that's good homework. No,
I'm
that's
good
gonna, homework.
I'm actually going to give you a couple of realtors that I know and the one that sold me my house.
I want you
to just start looking. Like,
done.
And my realtor was great. She wasn't pushy. She was very helpful to me.
Ma'am, I have $1. What's going on here?
She'll be like, okay. No, but she really was great. And so if you're looking to buy a home, you know, visit letstarttoday.com and you can search for buying a home. And there's a lot of tips and tricks there that you might need for that. So make sure you check back on Wednesday, July 18th for episode 2. That's when we're going to talk all about the job market.
Don't forget to rate, review, and subscribe to Colorful Lives on Apple Podcasts, SoundCloud, or Spotify. You can follow me on social media at Aminatou, AminaTou.
You must have got that early.
Girl, always.
Well, I got at Angela Yee, so that worked out too.
And you can find me at MyFabFinance, as fab as in fabulous finance.
You can join the conversation on social media and use the hashtag LiveColorful. That's colorful with 2 L's at the end.
Colorful Lives, presented by State Farm, is a Loudspeaker Studio production. Our executive producers are Matt Raz and Chris Morrow. The show was engineered and edited by Dwayne Crawford. For more information on Colorful Lives and other Loudspeakers podcasts, follow at LSN Podcast on Twitter or Loudspeakers Network on Instagram.